Good morning. Please note that today's presentation contains forward-looking statements that are subject to various risks and uncertainties. Please refer to Intel's most recent earnings release and annual report in Form 10-K and other filings with the SEC for more information on the risk factors that could cause actual results to differ materially from our expectations.
In the township of Quo, where many folks lacked vision, Chief Geek Pat and Sales Guy Shell were shopkeepers on a mission. They thought what Quo needed was a spark of inspiration, so they whipped up a batch of woohoo chips they knew would cause a sensation. A rush, a tingle, a feast for the eyes. These chips soon helped Quo's status to rise. Energy, retail, fintech, and more. Business exploded with lions out the door. Manufacturing output 10x'd overnight. Medical breakthroughs, education done right. The market was buzzing every day, every night. And with each woohoo chip, innovations took flight. The world took notice of Quo's fantastical feat. All thanks to those chips, making enterprise sweet. Bringing AI everywhere. That's what good partners do. Intel's enterprise solutions for you.
Please welcome Chief Commercial Officer Christoph Schell.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to day two of Intervision 2024. Great to see you all here in the room. We talked yesterday a bit about AI for good, and I have to do that again. Did you see how slim I was in that AI booty? It's awesome. I think I'm going to send it to my wife. It's the new me, okay? I really like it. It's awesome. Today is all about you, our customers. We are talking about AI everywhere, PC, edge, data center, cloud. And we want to make this work for you. We will unleash the power of AI today for you. And we will do that with no better person than my supervisor, our chief geek, Pat Gelsinger. Please welcome him on stage.
Okay.
Have fun.
Oh my, good morning. Welcome to Vision 2024 and welcome to Arizona. You know, as I like to call it, the Silicon Desert. And Arizona has been a manufacturing hub for Intel for over 40 years we've been here. And this is the center for not only at-scale manufacturing, but some of the most advanced packaging research, literally, on the planet, you know, today. And we were here a few weeks ago. I brought a friend along, you know, his name's President Biden, right, and Secretary Raimondo. And I'll say it was a proud moment to be on the West Lawn, August of 22, when we signed the CHIPS Act into law. It was a proud moment, yeah. And it was a proud moment in Arizona on March 20th when we had the first major releases of the CHIPS Act coming to Intel for our Ocotillo facility, the largest investment in the semiconductor industry in history. So thank you all for participating in that. And as I think about the CHIPS Act, I call it the most important industrial policy since World War II. And I just ask each one of you, what aspect of your life is it becoming more digital? Everything. And everything digital runs on semiconductors, which means the world is increasingly critical on what we do, on what Intel does. And so will your companies, you know, so will your families, so will every aspect. And we're just seeing this accelerate as the era of AI is driving this huge momentum, right? And we call it, you know, AI everywhere. And with that, we're evolving Intel in a fundamental way. Intel Foundry, the systems foundry for the AI era, and Intel products, the modular platforms for the AI era. But let's spend just a moment on manufacturing. You know, this newly created Intel Foundry business, the world's first and only systems foundry for the AI era. And we're committed by the end of the decade to be the world's number two foundry on a fast growth trajectory for the future. You know, and, you know, manufacturing, of course, Intel products, you know, customer zero, as I like to call it, you know, but also opening the doors of our manufacturing for the first time ever to be the manufacturing partner for companies across the industry. You know, and this idea of Intel products and Intel Foundry, an incredibly powerful combination. And if you think about this period of time that we're in, you know, maybe the most intense period of innovation that the technology industry has ever been part of, you know, and for somebody who's been in it for over 40 years, that's a pretty profound statement. 40 years, hard to say. I'm still young, I still feel good, yeah. And we'll spend the bulk of our time today on modular systems for the AI era, Intel products. And, you know, I sort of looked at the prior decade as sort of boring. You know, we made PCI Gen a little bit faster. We made DDR the next increment. You know, we kicked up the thermal envelope a little bit. You know, we added a few more cores and we said, okay, it's a good chip. Boring. AI is making everything exciting like we haven't seen. You know, in this period of time, you know, a fundamental drive of computing, the biggest change in technology since the internet. And it's going to reshape every aspect of our business and yours. And I simply call it every company becomes an AI company. You know, and this becomes the driving force of this expanding semiconductor TAM from about 600 billion to more than a trillion by the end of the decade. You know, and Intel is rooted in how can we help? How can we understand your needs? And we believe, you know, you need technology infrastructure that's scalable and flexible, built on standard platforms that enables privacy and security, top-notch data quality and availability, that gives you choice, competition, you know, time to value, open ecosystems, and helps you to bring new talent to keep up with this incredible pace that you're in. And fundamentally, you need tangible business outcomes. That's why we're here. You know, we don't build technology for the fun of it. It's lifting our businesses to new heights through this power of AI. And Intel's on a mission to bring AI everywhere. You know, and with that, making it more accessible for every one of you and your customers, your employers, from the clients to the edge and data center to the cloud and networks. And this will be the framework for today's discussion and how we help enable AI for every aspect of your business. So let's start by taking a look at the client, right? And that powerful, as Andy Grove called it, the ultimate Darwinian device that enables AI at the fingertips of every one of your customers and employee. You know, I like to think of the AI PC like the Centrino moment. Now, some of you, when I say that, a few of you know what that means? Okay, well, thank you, humor me, right? You know, I've been around for a while. But, you know, we standardized Wi-Fi for several years, and it sort of went nowhere. You know, there's a few access points and so on, and then we put it into a volume platform that we drove into the industry, and all of a sudden, every coffee shop, every hotel, every office became wirelessly enabled. It changed the platform, it changed the use cases. And this is exactly what we're doing with the AI PC, where Intel is driving, you know, this new platform evolution, the AI PC. You know, and we're ramping Core Ultra rapidly. And when we launched it in December, we had great response from the industry. Today, we've already shipped over 5 million units. We're on track, you know, right, MJ? On track, you know, to meet or beat our 40 million unit goal this year, 100 plus million next year. You know, we are underway. We just launched the commercial versions in February of Core Ultra. You know, we're expanding our AI PC developer program, also and now IHVs and ISV programs to go with it. 500 plus AI models are now optimized for Core Ultra. And of course, working with our OEM partners, Dell, HP, Lenovo, our roadmap is strong. Off to a good start, but with Lunar Lake, Arrow Lake, Panther Lake, the roadmap is strong. And in particular, I'm quite excited about the next platform. You know, where before competitors shipped their first chips, you know, we're launching our second. You know, Lunar Lake, 3x the AI performance. This little marvel has over 100 platform TOPS, 45 NPU TOPS alone. And before others get started, we're on to the second generation, the third generation's in fab, because we're going to drive the AI PC category to every fingertip of your users and your customers. You know, and just like with Wi-Fi, after you've started to use an AI PC, you can't imagine not. What do you mean? You don't have a Wi-Fi connection? What's the matter with you? Get rid of this piece of trash. You know, AI will be enabling every business-critical worker, automating, streamlining, collaborating, new insights. And later in the keynote, we'll give you some examples of those use cases. And you need to capitalize on this opportunity. You need to refresh. You know, on things like office productivity alone, almost a 50% improvement over a three-year-old PC, and most of you have four- and five-year-old PCs. Time to upgrade. You know, battery life, new form factors, security, Windows 10, end of life. And all of these, the killer reason is the new AI use cases, Microsoft Copilot, Adobe Developer, Zoom, Teams, summarization, translation, contextualization. Every application is going through an AI makeover. And without Intel Core Ultra, you're going to miss out. Simply put, time to refresh. I was with a major CIO recently, and they were like most companies, their typical boring four-year refresh cycle. You know, and through COVID, it sort of extended a little bit, sort of 5 years. And we started to go through the use cases that he personally would start to take advantage of, right? Next phone call, CIO, we need to start planning our upgrade cycle now, right? An upgrade cycle, 10,000 might take, you know, 12 to 15 months to drive an upgrade cycle. Windows 10 EOL is roughly 18 months out. My challenge to you, leave today, call your head of IT. Ask what your AI PC upgrade refresh policy is. And if it's not underway yet, tell them to give you a plan. And if you don't get a good answer, I'll call them for you. So the next piece of bringing AI everywhere is edge and enterprise. And we see that, you know, the edge is this conglomeration of lots of different platforms, lots of different solutions. But the killer app for the next generation of edge is AI. Right, and all of a sudden, video, analytics, taking advantage of these vast quantities of data that are at the edge and largely wasted today. And Intel's been delivering edge platforms for many decades, and now we're building on those open standard platform investments, enabling you to bring these new analytical processes, data, you know, harvesting to those platforms. And I call it the three laws of the edge. And we see this idea of AI edge becoming really important, but should the AI happen in the cloud or at the edge? And I call it the three laws, the laws of economics, the laws of physics, and the laws of the land. You know, economics, it's simply too expensive to bring your data back to the cloud. It gives you better cost control. You know, bandwidth is the most expensive resource, you know, that you have. And cloud is the most expensive compute that you have in the fleet. So the laws of economics, move it to the edge. But second is the laws of the physics, as I like to say. And how many of you have changed the speed of light this week? You know, hey, you know, whether it's skill shortages, quality, security, all of those things, you know, what's the round trip requirement? What's the user interface expectations for instantaneous response? Or how fast does the robotic arm need a response? If it's 20 milliseconds, you can't 200 millisecond round trip to the cloud. The laws of physics draw you to the edge. And, you know, hey, we're pretty profound technologists, but we ain't changing the speed of light. But maybe the third is the most powerful, the laws of the land. And we often need to keep data on-prem for privacy, regulatory, security reasons. And data laws have become increasingly diverse and restrictive by regions across the world. And you know, every nation has some form of GDPR, capabilities, and this volume of data to tap in at the edge is simply staggering. And again, I was with the CIO recently, and he was describing the 100-plus companies they operate in and all the different data privacy and regulatory requirements. The idea of bringing data back to the cloud, no way, was his response. Couldn't even fathom the idea of moving data out of region for these use cases. So the three laws. And as the edge becomes increasingly important, it's going to become, we believe, the dominant AI workload. Research indicates that by 2026, 50% of edge computing deployments will involve machine learning and AI, compared to just 5% today. A killer use case. Now, one of the things I've really become infatuated with as we've studied these AI use cases, it's all about unleashing your data. And how does your, this massive proprietary data sets, how can we turn it loose, for AI deployments? And RAG, retrieval augmented generation, is like so cool, right? It sort of is this perfect bridge, between cool new LLMs and the big data repositories that you have today. And RAG becomes, I think, one of the most important workflows, for corporations to take advantage of their data and generative AI, where I can take modern open source LLMs and, maybe if you're really good, you're updating and retraining those. What do you think? Maybe once a week, maybe once a month? How often are you updating the LLMs, right, that you have? But then you're combining it with real-time data coming through your vector databases, your streaming, unstructured databases as well. And bringing both of those together in real time, we think is extraordinarily powerful. When RAG as a database encodes domain-specific, business-specific, data, and then packages that together for these complex queries into open standard LLM environments. Provides better real-time data. Combining this gives better business results. And with the rise of Gen AI in the workplace, how do you apply it to your business problems and challenges? So, what do you think? Me giving a speech or me giving you a demo? Let's look at a demo and have Diana here help us.
I'm Pat. Hey.
So, Diana, can you help solve this problem? How can I take big data farms and combine it with modern LLMs?
Exactly. Well, I think you kind of alluded to the answer, but I mean, LLMs are really cool, but they're not always the most up-to-date, and they may not have access to the most relevant information, like company proprietary data, for example. And as I think you mentioned, you can actually solve that by adding a RAG to your LLM. So let's take a look at this. We actually have here, I've got two chatbots. They're both running Llama 2, the 70 billion parameter LLM on Gaudi 2, but that left one's just a stock one. The right one's got RAG added, running a Redis vector database on Xeon 6 with performance cores and MCR memory from Micron.
Okay.
So we'll try a prompt or two and see what kind of response
Show
we get.
Show me something.
All right. So the first one I've already got here, we're going to ask something that's going to be something we're asking for very, up-to-date information, and we'll see, how these two LLMs work on this.
Okay, they're both giving us some answers.
They're both giving us some answers, so that's great. And let's see, we'll try to zoom in a little bit here. So this is the stock one. You can see we're asking for this information from Intel Vision.
I don't have specific information.
Yes.
Yeah, sort of sad.
It is a little sad. It is a little sad. It's not very helpful.
Yes, I have information.
I have information here. Very, very current information. And that's what you want. I mean, otherwise, what's the point?
Yeah, okay. So that's cool. So you got any others?
I do. Let's try another one. I'm going to do a little cut and paste here, spare you my typing skills, which are not stellar. So this question I think you'll be interested in, this is TCO benefits of the RAG solution on Gaudi 2 on Xeon. So let's see what kind of response we get there.
Okay.
Once again, the stock llama, it's giving us a bunch of words.
Yeah, sort of.
I'm not sure the words are helpful.
Yeah, sort of like one of my uncles. Lots of words, not much information.
Pretty much, exactly. That's a great analogy.
Yeah.
So you can see we've got a lot of words. It's not really giving us too much information. It's kind of just sort of guessing at things.
Yeah.
Whereas over here, on the RAG solution, we are getting very specific information. We are actually getting some really nice numbers.
Okay,
to 1.5
I love that.
Better TCO.
Yeah, crushingly
over
good
TCO. H100.
Okay, yeah.
So
yeah.
I figured you'd like that.
So good job.
So yeah, very specific. And the other thing is, we're not just throwing numbers at you. We are actually citing the sources. So
okay.
You know where these
able
numbers
to pull
came
all
from.
The data from our
yeah,
internal sources.
Yeah, you know, you don't have to worry. We're like making this up, and who knows where it came from. So very, very great results there.
Okay.
Maybe one more prompt for the software people in the audience?
Yeah, let's try something. Maybe not all of them are TCO hardware folks. Let's try some software.
There's probably some software people out there, so let's ask a software question. Forecast data, AI software market revenue growth. Let's see what we get for that. Oh, I can already see the stock Llama 2 is hidden in the, I don't have access to real-time data. That seems to be a common remark there. So yes, no access. We're throwing out some numbers here, a variety of numbers, so we're just kind of, you know, we're trying to come up with something, but who knows where those numbers came from and how accurate they are.
And it sounds definitive, but it's wrong.
It sounds, but there's two definitives, so we got two definitives, so anyway. But here we have a definitive number and the source, so something that you can feel much more confident about.
Okay.
And I should try one more quick one here. The thing that I thought was interesting about this is the original question. If I change this just slightly, to say information instead of data. Now, I personally don't distinguish. I could have said either one, right?
Sound like synonyms to me.
I know, it seems like the same question. So I ask essentially to me the same question. And you can see as the information's coming down through here, the Llama 2 is giving us essentially a different answer. In this case, it's like just giving us one of the numbers. It didn't give us two. So it's like, well, did it make the other one up before? Mm-hmm. I mean, where did it get that from? Whereas this one, if you can
exactly
see, we're getting exactly the same. Yes.
Yeah, very cool.
Yeah.
So better answers, you know, more current, real-time information. But what about performance?
Oh, performance. Right. So we've got some good news there, too. Up to 2.35 better performance on this Xeon 6 and Redis solution compared to the previous gen. So more users, more LLMs, the same platform. Really good news there.
Excellent. Well, Diana, like always, you're the best.
Thanks, Pat.
And, right, I mean, there's lots of things going on in the AI space, right? You know, models and training and MOE. But this idea of RAG, of combining your data in real time, right, with the latest in LLM work, I think this is really powerful to unlock this asset that you have. You know, and this is really, you know, right, broadening the exposure of your confidential information, building on what you already have, where your data already is, and enabling it in new and profound ways. But of course, this still is sort of complicated. And as we think about that, you know, we've clearly seen that there's interest in how we can move these standards forward. Standard management, no networking lock-in, no new security issues, working with LLMs that you know can run natively on Xeon, but also with Gaudi 2 and 3 and NVIDIA. And now is the time to build open platforms for enterprise AI. And we're working to address key requirements that include how you efficiently deploy utilizing existing infrastructure, seamless integration with hardened enterprise software stacks that you have today, you know, the high degree of reliability, availability, security, support issues. But Intel's not the only one seeing those challenges as well. And we have strong support from the companies that are listed here. You know, and some of the big critical players who control so much of your data infrastructure, SAP, IBM, Red Hat, you know, VMware, and more. And based on the strong ecosystems of support, you know, that we're seeing and the incredible response we're seeing from the industry players, we'll soon be launching an open platform, these reference designs and solutions that bringing us together will allow us to build the blueprints, you know, have the reference design available, demonstrate performance, interoperability, trustworthiness, and you know, ensure effective benchmarking and certification of these solutions as well, and providing open governance so that the entire ecosystem is moving forward, you know, together. And Intel is stepping up to provide access to this, to deliver our blueprints into the marketplace, but also make it easy. And I like to think of Intel Developer Cloud as sort of the easy button, right? You know, hey, how can we spin up, you know, a Gaudi cluster and have Xeons available? How can IDC be this fast path for test, deploy, and, you know, solutioning work that you would do? And we'll be delivering these blueprints, these authored, you know, development environments. And stay tuned, you know, at the Open Source Summit next week in North America or in Seattle, we'll be rolling out many of the next steps for this open platform for enterprise AI. And we see RAG as such a huge enabler, this private data that you haven't been able to monetize in your businesses forever, and combining it with LLMs. What a powerful model. And let's talk to somebody who's working every day with customers to enable enterprise AI. Please welcome and joining to the stage Accenture's Chief AI Officer, Lan Guan. Lan, so good for having you join
Thank
us here
you for
as well.
Having me here.
Yeah, that's like one of the coolest titles, Chief AI Officer.
I'm so excited to be here to meet so many AI visionaries in one place. Thank you.
Yeah, very good. So you work with customers across the industry to develop their AI strategies, help them drive value and growth. And what are the biggest challenges they're seeing?
Sure. This is what I do every day with 1,000 Gen AI projects under the belt. I have so many lessons to share.
Thousands of Gen AI projects?
Yes. Wow. But today I will focus on three common challenges to AI adoption. One, ambiguous value realization.
Okay.
So many clients are telling me it's really hard to realize value from their AI investment. And that's even with very well-defined, you know, AI KPIs, metrics, things like that. And oftentimes, that's because they are only associating AI KPIs to the task level, right? So having this kind of a task-oriented, task-centric approach, you're missing out a lot of aggregate value on the holistic level. That's why in Accenture, we are a big proponent of, okay, you really need to take an enterprise reinvention approach by implementing AI across your entire workflow, or in some cases, even disrupting your existing workflow. Okay. The second challenge is insufficient data quality. The old saying of garbage in, garbage out cannot be more true in the age of Gen AI.
Are you telling me they have garbage data?
Yes, and I can tell you this is one of the most common challenges many clients face. For companies who are using pre-built LLMs, they don't trust the data coming from the public internet, right? Because that's a major source of a hallucination. For some progressive companies who are also trying to fine-tune or pre-train their own models, they also are lacking confidence, about their internal company data. So let me give you one example. Since Accenture does so much work in contact center AI, one of my clients are telling me they actually have 37 versions of standard operating procedure, which is supposed to be
standard.
One single version of a tool.
Good.
So the third challenge is widen talent gaps. Many people think that there's an easy button, right? You can just press a button, Gen AI will come out. That's not the case. Many organizations need talents to build AI, operate AI, also manage AI. And that's also not forget about a lot of business users that you need to be training so that they can do effective prompt engineering to get very relevant data, very relevant response.
Well, cool. So those three. So what's your advice for our customers and audience here?
Yes, I have a lot of advice. But in Accenture, we try to simplify this into 5 imperatives. I already talked about the top 3. Lead with value. It's time to build your digital core with data foundation, with AI foundation. 3 is, you know, bridge your talent gaps. But let me give you 2 bonus ones. The fourth one is actually, it's time to fix your responsible AI solution, right? So let's not be theoretical. Let's not just talk about responsible AI guardrails. Now start implementing responsible AI systematically using technology solution. Last but not the least, it's You know, Gen AI is not one and done. It's all about continuous reinvention. So take a very modularized approach. Be ready for a multi-year journey. So for the audience in the room here, are you ready to embark on such an exciting journey with me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good. And Lon, you know, thank you so much for joining us. The partnership with Accenture truly is fabulous, and we work with you in so many domains, and it really honors us to have somebody who's the AI expert of Accenture here on the stage with us. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you.
You know, and the third on our journey is what we do in the data center and in the cloud. And, you know, Intel's been innovating in this area for many years. PCIe, memories, thermal, you know, networking solutions. We've been driving more into our core CPU platform, new capabilities like AMX, and driving standards for big data, classical machine learning and inferencing. And the Xeon Innovation Machine is not slowing down. And we're going to cover a little bit of that today. And we're seeing this very rapid evolution of AI workloads. And even as accelerated computing has taken this primary role, you know, Gaudi, our accelerator solution for that, we're going to cover that in a little bit. But let's start by looking a bit more closely at the Xeon portfolio. And I'm very happy to announce the next generation of Xeon, Xeon 6 processors, the new brand for our next generation of both efficient core and performant core solution, Xeon 6. And with the rapid rise in computing requirements and the immense data sets that we're working with, workloads are driving trade-offs for performance, efficiency, and density. And in return, more demand for CPUs and cores that deliver better performance per watt. And I'm happy to share that the next generation, you know, is enabling for the first time our Xeon 6 with E-core uniquely addressing these challenges. You know, and this is based on Intel 3, one of my five nodes per 4 years. You know, so this is sort of like, you know, Papa's little baby here. You know, one of our nodes here as we're coming into market. And this is our first volume part on Intel 3 that we'll be bringing into the marketplace. And super excited, you know, it's coming along very well, and we'll be moving Sierra Forest into production this quarter, and we'll be working with our customers, our OEMs, to make that available. And we're seeing this ability to deliver distinct advantages, you know, for cloud native, you know, for volume container solutions, hyperscale workloads, and delivering up to 2.7x better rack density, 2.5x performance per watt improvements. And when you think about that, how many of your data centers have excess power budget? No, right? And every watt, right, is a TCO challenge for you. And, you know, let's just take an example of a telco server deployment, you know, where they might have 200 racks using second-gen Xeon for their infrastructure for their telco environment. With Xeon 6, with E-cores, we can reduce that down to just 72 racks. Same performance, same capabilities, and less management, less networking, you know, less things to upgrade, less things to be supporting the environment. And this results in over 1 megawatt of power savings in a traditional data center, or 1,300 Arizona homes, you know, now have energy sources available to them. Xeon 6 platforms also provide up to 27% lower embodied carbon footprint. So we're driving down the amount of carbon in our supply chain as well. You know, and simply put, it frees up energy capacity, builds TCO efficiency, improves physical space that enables our next generation Gen AI and P-Core solutions into the marketplace. Well, the big brother of Sierra Forest is our Xeon Gen 6 processor, formerly known as Granite Rapids, with P-cores. And of course, right, you know, we have one of those wafers here too. What a surprise, right? And here's our Granite Rapids Intel 3 wafer, right, which will be launching shortly after the Sierra Forest product, and we're quite excited to be ramping this into the marketplace this year, also on the Intel 3 process technology. So it's sort of like twins, right? Now, you know, I've touched on this idea of your data stack. And almost every one of your data stacks runs on Xeon, right? It's where the databases are running. And amazingly, here we are in year 22 or so of the cloud journey, and the majority, over 60% of computing is now done in the cloud or in some cloud embodiments, but the vast majority of data is still on-prem. And indications are that 66% of that data is unused, and 90% of the unstructured data is unused. What a value unlock. And this idea of LLMs and RAG gives us extraordinary opportunity to unlock this hidden asset that you and your businesses aren't being able to leverage and operate on today. And Xeon is clearly a tremendous machine for running these RAG environments and making LLMs more effective and efficient on your data. You know, and Xeon is not only able to be your database front end, but increasingly, it's able to run the LLMs as well. No new management, no new networking, no new security models, no new IT, you know, things to learn, no proprietary networking. It just works on the industry standard Xeons that you know and love. And you know, we're seeing some extraordinary steps in the AI computing landscape, advances in algorithms and new data types that make the AI infrastructure more efficient. Now, some of this data type stuff I just find amazing. So here I am, I'm a young engineer, and I am helping to establish IEEE P754. How many of you know what that was? That was the 64-bit IEEE floating point standard that also included 80-bit mode capabilities for maximum precision. Anybody remember that stuff? Yeah, I worked on that. Man, that was like, precision, wazoo. I couldn't believe some of those crazy rounding modes and stuff. And now we have 32-bit floating point, and then BF16 for 16-bit, and then FP8, and now FP4? It's like just guessing, right? And these narrower formats, though, are allowing memory compression, efficient training, and inferencing with minimal accuracy loss. And Intel is working closely to drive standards in this space, in particular the Microscaling Formats, or MX Alliance, working with companies like ARM, Qualcomm, and NVIDIA to standardize the next generation data types for both training and inferencing, enabling innovation, advancements in the algorithms, enabling memory compression, allowing lower cost and more efficient solutions. And one such format is called MXFP4. I know it just rolls off your tongue, practice it, right? Or it's a floating point 4-bit standard, for how you can have Radix and Mantissa operate effectively in this environment without sacrificing accuracy. And with that, let me introduce you to the next star of the Gen AI show, the Xeon 6 P-Core, or Granite Rapids, that we were looking over. And what I want to show you here, right, so here's my Granite Rapids, quite excited for this baby coming into the marketplace this year. But let's get started by looking at four different tech streaming services that are running on three generations of Xeon. And over here, right, we have two generations of Gen 4, right, we have Gen 5, and then Xeon 6 here. And what we're going to do is we're going to take one common Llama 2 70B parameter, and 70B, a pretty chunky parameter, that's a pretty chunky model, so a pretty big thing. And in our first two systems, we're going to write a haiku about Intel AI solutions, and this one's going to be using FP16, and this one's going to be using the 4-bit that we just described. So let's kick these off, and we're going to see the comparison of just moving to the 4-bit format on the same generation of hardware. So we'll get this kicked off. write a haiku about Intel AI solutions. Okay, sure. And quickly running through it, and we see over here, you know, 170 milliseconds of latency, and not quite done over here yet. We're getting to it shortly here. And what you'll see is about a 3x improvement in the latency just as we move to the modern data types, you know, for FP4. Well, that's pretty good, don't you think? Yeah, that's sort of for free. Okay, now let's go from Gen 4 to Gen 5, and we're gonna run the same query, and we'll see how long it takes us on a Gen 5 machine. And we'll have this guy run through here. So here's a haiku about Intel AI software solutions. And we're now at 150 milliseconds, or about a 3x reduction as we went from Gen 4 to Gen 5. What do you think? Pretty good? And that is really good. But most would say 100 milliseconds is sort of the threshold. So, you know, for, you know, a model size and query types, so can we get below 100 milliseconds? What do you think? Can we get below 100 milliseconds? Maybe. Let's give it a try. And we'll kick this baby off here. If I hit the Enter versus the Shift key. And over here, we'll quickly see that's 82 milliseconds. So, you know, literally across three generations of Xeon, taking advantage of our latest innovations on Granite Rapids, Monument Creek memory, the highest performance DRAM, you know, memory, combining that with FP4, you know, model MXFP4 capabilities, brings us clearly in range where I can now run very hefty models right on the Xeon, you know, platform. From fourth gen Xeon with 16 bits up to, you know, today, less than 100 milliseconds, 6.4x improvement from Gen 4 to Xeon 6 on a 70 billion parameter, you know, model, you know, and again, without major upgrades, just run it in your data centers. This is, you know, Llama 2 70B parameters, no expensive proprietary stuff, crap, whatever, entering your data center, right? Unleashing the most dramatic source of business already available, taking advantage of the data in your data center, in your databases that's available today. Now, that's really good, but one of the other things that comes next to this is as we unleash the value of your data, what's the security model? What's the security profile associated with it? And in an AI everywhere world, security becomes even more important as we unleash your data sources. And we need to be able to confidently bring zero trust environments to your fingertips. And this is why Intel's been working aggressively, you know, to build out confidential computing, where there's increasing concern for, you know, the stringent policies that you have around data, increasing regulatory environments that you see, you know, not just on data, but the EU AI Act and the US executive order on safe and secure, you know, trustworthy AI, you know, and all of these things put more demands on the security model. And that's why Intel TDX that we debuted in our fourth gen Xeon processors are now available in Alibaba, Azure, Google, IBM Cloud, and at various stages of coming to broad market availability. And just this week, Google Cloud is announcing, you know, the public preview of its next gen confidential VM services leveraging Intel TDX. So now it's sort of, how do I leverage my standard capabilities and bring modern AI models and algorithms in a trusted execution model. And Intel is also enabling that with the Intel Trust and Attestation Services, so that you have independent attestations of the security models, of the model training that's going on. And we're enabling this across all members of the Xeon family, and we're going to extend that to Gaudi later this year. We're going to support extending that trust domain into other accelerators like NVIDIA, and with Panther Lake, our 25 client product, bringing it all the way to our edge and client offerings as well. So truly a full end-to-end confidential computing environment. And we hear more and more concern for the training. You know, who does control my model weights? And who is keeping my data secure? And how do I know it hasn't been tampered with? And this idea of being able to extend the trust domain and combine RAG with industry LLM capabilities, we see great momentum and customer adoption to this model in the industry. I think this is a sweet spot for enterprise AI adoption. But enterprises are also looking for cost-effective, high-performance, generative AI training and inferencing environments as well. And with that, we see them turning to models like Gaudi. And Intel Gaudi's price-performance advantages lie in three fundamental domains. First, choice. People want an alternative, right? You know, open software approach and investments, and providing time-to-market available lower TCO solutions. And Gaudi is the only benchmark alternative to the NVIDIA H100 for training LLMs. And Gaudi AI, we expect that we're just gaining momentum, and you're going to see today quite a number of customers coming on board as we see the acceleration of our Gaudi offerings in 24, 25, and beyond. But one of the other critical things that customers are saying is, boy, how do I stitch these together? And with bringing Xeon and Gaudi together, you know, it really is an AI system. But then how do I scale those systems in my data centers? And that's where the networking fabric comes to play. And customers are asking for open technology-based ecosystem for AI connectivity. And you know, while there's some proprietary solutions available, we also see that the Ultra Ethernet Consortium and the work that we're driving is standing up to fill this scale-up and scale-out networking domain. And when I was a young engineer, right, working on the 286, in the cube next to me were some of the engineers working on the first Ethernet solutions. I thought networking was pretty stupid at the time. You know, processing was great. But the venerable Ethernet remains the standard for how we do networking in the data center. And through UEC, Intel is revolutionizing building on Ethernet networking for AI fabrics for the future. And we'll be introducing an array of AI-optimized Ethernet solutions. This lineup will include cutting-edge AI NIC cards that we'll be delivering, standard NIC solutions. It will also include AI chiplets that will enable for our customers and partners in Intel Foundry. It will also include soft and hard IP through Intel Foundry, and it's building on and leveraging the work that we've done, integrating it fully into our Gaudi solutions as well. A range of soft and hard reference designs for AI connectivity, because we don't need proprietary networking for our AI solutions for the future. What do you think? Is that a winner? Because we're out to transform large scale-up and scale-out networkings, and being able to expand the sizes of these environments and build AI systems that you need in your enterprise without proprietary networking lock-ins in your environment. And we plan to deliver scalable reference designs, integrating hardware and software capabilities. You know, reference designs that provide, you know, from small models that fit in a PC to medium and large models for enterprise and edge, all the way up to big, bulky ones for the cloud and API access into other cloud services. But ensuring security, openness, confidentiality, and bringing your enterprise data to bear. And we're going to work very closely with our ecosystem of partners to make that available. And, you know, enterprises are leveraging a range of industry solutions to enable these cutting-edge environments. And I want to bring up one of our friends, one of our partners, who's helping us enable this AI future. So please join me in welcoming to the stage the head of tech and business enablement at Supermicro, Ray Peng. You know, Ray, you know, Supermicro have been such a great partner for Intel. You guys are so passionate about innovating. I just love to, you know, hear from you about some of the innovation journey we're doing together, starting all the way back with Gen 1 of Gaudi.
Absolutely. Thank you, Pat. So Supermicro embarked on the Gaudi journey since the very beginning. We developed an optimized AI server for Gaudi 1. We continued with Gaudi 2, and today we are working hard to bring a Gaudi 3-based solution to market. So Pat, I'd also like to share some customer success. Supermicro deployed the largest Gaudi 1 cluster in the world at the San Diego Supercomputer Center. The Voyager supercomputer, supported by the National Science Foundation, is designed to enable AI for science and has been in production for 2 years. This is way before the ChatGPT, the LLM discussion.
Yeah. It was before AI and HPC collided. Right.
That's
we,
right.
We were just building fast machines, and
absolutely.
With that, it's incredible. AI compute running on Intel Gaudi, directly influencing science, research, and the new breakthroughs there. And other scientists, other activities that we're working on.
Oh, absolutely. So, Pat, when you combine the power of Gaudi-based solution and put it in the hands of some of the smartest researchers across the country, great things can happen that benefit everyone, including all of us in this room. So it's really amazing. I also would like to share the success we have with Gaudi too. As we stand here talking, a SuperMicro team is working hard at the customer side.
Oh, which customer? you can't tell.
The customer actually is in the audience.
Okay.
If you want to stand up, I will mention your name. Okay. They are shy. They are Canadians. You have to forgive them.
Okay. In addition to big supercomputing, Gaudi is also meeting the needs of enterprise customers as well. Efficient, scale out, price performance as well.
Absolutely. You are exactly right, Pat. One of the biggest hurdles deploying large-scale AI infrastructure is power. Data centers around the world are literally running out of power. Mm-hmm. So how do we solve that problem? The answer is energy-efficient green computing. Green computing has been the DNA for Supermicro since the inception more than 30 years ago. That's how long you have been knowing our CEO, Charles Liang, right?
Yeah, you guys have been passionate about green computing since the very beginning of Supermicro.
Oh, absolutely. When you combine energy-efficient Gaudi with Supermicro's energy-efficient servers, customers can save not only upfront acquisition cost, but also ongoing operating cost.
And you guys have some demos you're showing here in the showcase as well, right?
Oh, absolutely. So, Pat, we are showing a text-to-image generation demo running live on Gaudi 2. We're actually running a fun computation, just see who can generate the images the fastest by typing the fastest. I don't know about you, but I'm a slow typer. For us to have a shot at winning, we have to cut and paste. We're also showing a real Gaudi 3 system, the world's first Gaudi 3 system.
Well, I haven't even announced it yet.
We're a little bit ahead.
Okay.
I encourage everybody to go to our booth, just check it out. It's real, it's not just on slide, it's not just talk. It's a real system in flesh, okay? So Pat, I'm really excited about all the new approach you guys start talking about, the system at the data center level for AI. At the Supermicro, we have been expanding our global manufacturing footprint to meet the rising demand from cloud service providers and enterprise customers. So today, we can deliver 5,000 fully integrated racks per month, including 1,350 liquid-cooled racks. So Pat, we'd love some of those racks at Gaudi racks.
Time to go to scale. So thank you for joining us today. We're excited about the partnership, and thank you for being here with our Vision audience today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ray.
Great being here. Thank you.
We're seeing momentum like Ray was talking about, so just driving customer deployments. And inside Intel, I say we have to be customer zero for our own AI activities. And we've been using different AI workloads for quite a number of years, some of that traditional machine learning, and applying meaningful and productive solutions into our environments. And I wanted to give you a glimpse of some of those learnings here this morning. Now, how many of you have bunny suited up and been in a fab? Okay, you know, a number of you had. Well, guess what? We're all going bunny suiting right now, right? So just down the road is our Ocotillo facility, and in it, right, we're going to go and see a live demonstration of Gaudi's and AI PCs, and we're going to walk into the fab right now and show you the magic that happens behind the scenes a little bit. So with that, let me invite Rajshree here, and Rajshree is literally bunny suited up inside of the fab. So, and here's our Ocotillo campus just down the road. And now we're moving into the fab. And Rajshree, can you hear me?
Hey, Pat, thanks for having me. Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes, you're coming through great, and thank you. And, you know, Rajshree, as I promised you, I have just a few thousand of my closest friends here, right? So don't worry about telling them anything confidential. They're all personal and friendly, so we're good, right, as well.
Yeah, thanks. Let me show you some of our latest AI innovations transforming our manufacturing workflow.
Well, fantastic, Rajshree, and Intel customer number one for our Gen AI solutions. So tell us more.
So here's one way we are using generative AI in the fab. One of our goals is to keep our equipment up and running all the time. So when we have an incident on a fab equipment, we want to find out if similar incidents have occurred in the past so that we can understand the root cause and resolve them. And this is so that we can get the equipment back up quickly. Fortunately, we have a huge amount of structured and unstructured data spanning decades and millions of records documenting our operations. We can reference this massive body of data to find a resolution to get the equipment back up. However, this process is time-consuming and can take hours and sometimes even days.
Yeah, and this certainly isn't ideal. Thousands, you know, we have fabs across the globe, you know, thousands of different engineers and equipment are running daily and growing worldwide.
Yeah, but now we have a game changer. We've started using LLM-based generative AI solutions to enhance our productivity. Let me show you. So let's suppose you have an incident on some equipment. You can come here and use natural language to search for the incident. So here, I'm typing an example. So on the right, you can see relevant past events that are similar based on the semantic search performed. And on the left, the AI assistant has generated the most likely root cause and resolution for the incident based on historical data. You can also summarize the steps performed to address the root cause. So here you see the work orders that contain those steps. And you can identify unique tasks. And when appropriate, you can even launch a software agent that can refine those tasks and take actions to bring the equipment back up.
Wow, this is pretty incredible, Rajshree. Literally a few clicks, right? And you're getting decades of data and being able to operationalize solutions. This is incredible.
Right, and it's that simple. What I like most about this is just how much time it saves. With just a few clicks, we can identify the root cause, resolution, and even at times bring equipment back online using an LLM-based Gen AI solution and our state-of-the-art factory automation software agent.
Well, thank you, Rajshree. This is incredible. And obviously, we're doing a whole lot of things, you know, for equipment downtime, automation improvement, you know, and this, you know, idea of, you know, we're using the Articulate software, you know, on-prem, secure, Gaudi infrastructure for our solution. And, you know, Articulate, been a partner company that we helped to start up. And this is all inside of a proprietary multi-VPN environment. I mean, this is the core of the core of Intel's operations. So, you know, obviously this never leaves our facility under any circumstances whatsoever. And now we're able to demonstrate the most advanced Gen AI capabilities in real time. But one more thing, Rajshree, was that an AI PC I saw that you had there?
Yes. This is the this is an AI PC, and let me show you something else. So with the Intel Arc graphics on this AI PC, our image processing procedure is 1.5 to 2x faster compared to previous technologies, and up to 10x faster than CPU-only calculations. In the past, obtaining high-resolution images, such as the ones that you see on the right, that are used for finding the locations of defects on a die, required additional processing on inspection tools and could affect the throughput. We solved this problem by training a cutting-edge super-resolution algorithm and using the latest generation of Intel processors for inferencing. We can now process these images directly on our laptops, such as this AI PC, and get detailed high-resolution images in under 1 second.
Well, hey, Rashree, this is fabulous. Those are great examples of how AI is making life so much easier, productive, and efficient. Let's say thank you to Rashree and our Octia fam. And these are real-world solutions. No, we are transforming our manufacturing operations, saving millions of dollars, accelerating our manufacturing process, improving yields in our factories and the productivity of our machines. And I want to repeat what I said earlier. Time to upgrade your AI PC fleet now. Because normally, right, you know, remember manufacturing, supply chains, those kind of things, you know, the developers get the cool PCs, and then the mediocre ones, you know, go to the white collar workers, and then the crap ones, okay, we'll give those to the manufacturing. No! Call your head of IT. It is time for a PC AI refresh, because use cases like this show extraordinary value for fleet upgrades now. And the combination of Xeon, RAG, you know, Gaudi, extraordinary value in delivering these AI use cases into your enterprise environment now. Well, not far from the Ocotillo factory is another important place here in Arizona, right? Maybe even more important in some regards, Arizona State University. Intel's biggest source of new engineering talent. You know, we have just under 5,000 ASU graduates as part of the Intel workforce, an incredible institution that's been transforming themselves. And it is my pleasure to welcome to the stage ASU President Michael Crow.
Hey, man. Nice to see you.
Very good to see you, Michael. And hey, sorry to miss you a couple of weeks ago. I brought my friend POTUS along.
Yes, I was very sad not to be there.
You know, and you know, I recently spent a day talking to some of, you know, all day with some of the best and brightest minds in AI. Maybe a few of them were ASU, you know, grads. And they said, when it comes to AI, we have a pretty good idea of what's going to happen 6 months from now. We have a vague idea of, you know, 12 months, and post 2 years, not a clue, right? And what are you seeing from the faculty, the research work that's going on with your teams around AI?
Yeah, well, Pat, what we see is that AI is this monumental transformation moment. We've got 1,000 faculty members already being trained in AI systems. We've got 100 development projects and more that are coming up. This new technology that you're talking about here is unbelievably powerful because it empowers the personal learner, the personalized individual learning process. And so what we see is that you're going to have AI operating at every level, the level of the personal intelligent assistant to the individual, the assistant to the teacher, to the professor. And so we're working on all of those dimensions. We already have tens of thousands of users in our student body, more than 100,000, basically. So we're very excited, and this is a monumental, transformational technology moment.
Yeah, it really is. And this isn't like years out. You know, this is right now.
Right. Well, in fact, it's funny. You know, if you go on our Wi-Fi networks right now, you'll see tens of thousands of people using AI systems at the moment. So people that keep talking about, well, this is down the road, you're already asleep. It's it's already a rocket ship, and so it's already moving.
So let's talk a little bit about the pipelines of talent for tomorrow and how you and ASU are making those possible.
Well, we've been working on changing, you know, we've gone from 900 engineering graduates just a few years ago to 7,200 or so this year. We're very excited about how we're doing that. We found ways to defeat the barriers of calculus, to defeat the barriers of chemistry and biology, and to empower things using computational tools. Computational tools not yet AI-driven, as they will be. So what we see is that we're going to see unbelievable talent development trajectories, engineers with multiple majors, people that dream about being engineering, but maybe they didn't study calculus or math well enough in high school. They can get through that, no problem. And so what we see now is massive empowerment for talent to move in any direction that they want to go.
Yeah, that really is stunning how you're able to, you know, just expand the potential workforce by using AI and helping them over some of those blockers, you know, for them becoming engineers.
Well, AI is interesting. It buys into our model as a technology of what we call abundance versus deficit. So most education systems in the country and around the world are built on the deficit model. What you don't know, you're too stupid to learn this, you're no good, you're this, you're this, you're this. And so AI empowers the abundance of the individual human being's ability to learn. So we see it as an unbelievable enabling machine to overcome the limits of teaching, to overcome the limits of individual humans being the only teachers. And so we think that this is a huge enhancement.
Well, you know, we are so excited about the Intel-ASU partnership, how you're being one of the most innovative, driving forces in higher education in America today. We are honored to have Michael Crowe join us on stage and be
a
partner with
Intel. Thank you.
You know, and based on talented engineers at Intel and across the industry, you know, we're seeing this growing momentum of customer adoption and how do I enable AI for my solution? And with that, we're seeing more and more of them taking advantage of the power of Gaudi to do so. And our customers and partners are looking to deliver cutting-edge solutions to serve their customers in need. And you know, for instance, at Bosch, you know, they're doing incredible work in this area. And Tanja, you made it, right? Straight from Germany. Please join me in welcoming, you know, Tanja Rickert to the stage. You know, hey, you know, you saw from our fab that we're pretty excited about what we're doing in manufacturing and bringing AI here. Such a pleasure to have you make it in, you know, for this moment. And tell us a little bit about your role at Bosch.
Yeah, and in the morning you told me maybe not everybody knows about Bosch. Does everybody knows about Bosch? It's actually the leading technology provider in Europe, and it's more than 400,000 associates, employees helping us with nearly 100 billion turnover. But it's more about the solutions. We go from mobility, we go to industry, energy and building, as well as consumer. And my role, I have also the honor to be on the board of management like you, or you're leading the board. And there I'm responsible for digital business and services, as well as our industry business, and for the region, you guess, North America.
Very good. So tell us about how Bosch is leveraging, you know, Gen AI, and, you know, we're taking this manufacturing engine to the next level.
So at Bosch, AI is at the heart of our products as well as our business processes. At Bosch, we have all products contain AI, are engineered with AI, or manufactured with AI. And we are looking continuously for partnerships, and we are very happy to partner now with Intel to go even faster. Yeah, we are developing since here, we are commercializing. You might have used, or for sure you have used, Bosch AI in your car since years. Okay. Or when you go, I said mobility, industry, consumer and buildings, in your kitchen. Do you have a connected oven from Bosch?
Not yet.
Oh, mistake. Because with the anonymized data from the baking and roasting, what this connected oven does, Gen AI, it recognizes the dish, what comes in, and it gives you a recommendation on temperature as well as time for cooking. But this is now, we want to go to manufacturing, right? You have shown me a very impressive
fab. The big stuff, yeah.
And our products are manufactured with AI, and what I have seen is your products as well. So there cannot be a better collaboration partnership to bring manufacturing with AI, with Intel Gaudi processors on the next level. So Maybe we go in more detail, or do you want to add?
And I think some of the work that we're mutually doing, right, together to enable your products, leverage our technologies, but also putting it to work for our factories, your factories as well. This is really incredible, Tanya, and we just so appreciate you coming here to join us on stage at Vision. Thank you so much for sharing today.
Yeah, and I think stay tuned. What we will do together in manufacturing, it's about optical inspection. And there, you always don't know if there are not okay products. And those are rare instances. And together, we decided now that we will make sure that we have more synthetic training data. And with the synthetic training data, you really have the chance to avoid this in the future. And this is what I'm looking forward to. And
very
this is
good.
Only the beginning of our journey.
Thank you so much, Tanya.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
Bosch, a venerable name, but a growing pipeline of customers. Another example, Nielsen IQ, consumer analytics leader, taking advantage of Gen AI with their Discover platform, domain-specific large language models, running on Gaudi and Xeons. Another example is Control S, one of the largest and fastest-growing data center and hosting providers in India and Asia. And boy, was I startled when I learned that India is very convinced they need their own models for their environment. And they're excited to train and be able to deliver that using Gaudi clusters. And other example, like international flavors and fragrances, where they're innovating in molecules for perfumes. And your next perfume could be Gen AI created. And no customer, example, with some of the leading minds in doing the research work of where AI is going for the future. And an example of that is Landing AI. And Andrew Ng, one of the most well-known minds in the area of AI research. And while Andrew couldn't be here himself today, let's hear the video message that he was able to share with us.
I'm thrilled to be here to discuss the transformative vision revolution with large vision models. The large language model, or LLM, revolution has transformed how we process text. And the large vision model, or LVM, revolution is just starting to change how we process images as well. But there's one important difference between LLMs and LVMs. Internet text sounds similar enough to your proprietary text documents, so an LLM trained on internet text can understand your documents. But a lot of businesses have images that look nothing like internet images, which is why you can do much better with an LVM large vision model adapted to your physical domain. Now, let me show you a quick demo of a pathology app using an LVM trained on pathology images. We've trained an LVM for histopathology with over 200,000 unlabeled images on the Gaudi 2 Intel DevCloud cluster. Since LVM training is compute intensive, we scale out to multiple nodes. Thanks to the Intel DevCloud team's help, we're able to get onboarded to the Intel DevCloud and port our LVM training recipes to run on the Gaudi 2 cluster. Once things were running and scale out, we're delighted at the speed up. Now, let's see this LVM in action. Here, I have the LVM running on the Gaudi 2 machine on Intel DevCloud. Using this LVM as a foundation, we've fine-tuned it with just a few examples to segment out the nuclei. As you can see, it does a great job. But the nice thing is that LVMs can do many different tasks. Using the same LVM, we could instead fine-tune it with some images of liver cells to create a classification model that can detect the presence or absence of cancer, like this. Your LVM acts as a pre-built template and eliminates the need to construct a new model from scratch every single time. I look forward to seeing more enterprises unlock intelligence from the image data and gain a competitive edge in the market. The future of large vision models is bright, and it's nice to see it running efficiently on the Intel DevCloud.
I love the work that they're doing, applying AI in new domains like healthcare and some of the research work, moving beyond text and language models. And another example customer, have you ever heard of Naver? right? You know, just a few years ago, I had never heard of them. And all of a sudden, you know, I realized they're one of the fastest growing Asian cloud service providers in the industry and a huge partner of Intel. So let's hear from their CEO right now.
Hi, everyone. I'm Suyeon Tae, CEO of Naver. Naver started as a search engine in Korea. We are now the number one internet company in Korea with around 700 million users across the globe. Our global services include Webtoon and Poshmark in the US and LINE in Japan. Today, at Intel Vision 2024, I'm happy to share about Naver's partnership with Intel. Naver was the third company globally to announce our own hyperscale Gen AI model. And for this model to work with our services and ecosystem, we must focus on R&D for powerful and cost-effective computing power. That's why we are very much excited about working together with Intel. I can't wait to see what Naver and Intel can create for a new AI chip environment and the innovations this will bring. Please stay tuned.
And in fact, you don't have to stay tuned very long. Let's bring on stage Dr. Ha, you know, the head of research for Naver Cloud. Yep. All right, so tell us how Intel and Naver are collaborating.
Thank you for your question. And our CEO, Suyeon, mentioned, as a global sovereign LLM pioneer and Korea's leading tech platform company, Naver has a vision to develop and deploy a powerful, innovative, and safe sovereign multimodal LLM trained with much more props. And so we decided to collaborate with Intel across three essential areas on Gaudi 2. The first, we established Naver Intel Core Lab to expand Gaudi software ecosystem in collaboration with many startups and research labs in academia with our Core Lab together. Second, we plan to evaluate Gaudi 2 and look forward to the successful evaluation to establish an LLM training infrastructure on Gaudi 2. Last, we expect to offer the commercial cloud instances of this LLM training infrastructures to global enterprises and public sectors for their competitiveness and innovations in new Gen AI era.
So why did you choose Gaudi? Why us?
Very good question. Indeed, it is the promising and competitive option for LLM training and inference. And they were confirmed the Gaudi's the foundational capability in executing compute operation for large-scale models. And with the Gaudi's AI dedicated design, it is able to deliver the outstanding performance per watt and TCO. Time to value is another key objective. With the Intel teams, the prompt and the responsive technical support, this collaboration aims for the Naver to deliver the most powerful LLM on high performance and cost effective, thus contributing to the vision of AI everywhere beyond our effort for AI sovereignty.
Well, thank you so much, and we look forward to many decades of great partnership with Naver. Thank you.
Thank you.
The AI pipeline for Gaudi continues to grow and accelerate, and a broadening amount of enterprise AI solutions, working with top OEMs like, you know, Supermicro, who we had here, HPE, and Lenovo. But I'm most excited to talk to you about our next guest, Michael Dell, joining us right now. Michael?
Hi, Pat. Hey, great to be with all of you. Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you, Michael. You and I, we've been doing technology for quite a while now. And, you know, with that, you know, it's just so marvelous to have you join us here at our Vision event today.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we've been doing a lot of work with our customers for decades. I think we might need some more fingers on the number of decades we've been doing this. But it's driven, you know, incredible outcomes. We've had this build out of compute and storage and networking and all these advances in power and speed and automation and intelligence. And now, you know, the software that's been built on top of that foundation. And all that has really come together in this moment where we're kind of moving from computation and calculation into cognition. And now we all have this sort of super genius cognitive capability right at our fingertips. And every organization needs to reimagine their business given this superpower that's being unleashed.
Yeah, that's exactly right, Michael. And, you know, we're just seeing this across different industries and use cases and moving so rapidly. And from your standpoint, where are enterprises on this journey? And what have you been hearing from your customers?
So with generative AI, enterprises are moving from pilot programs to production this year. And what they want are the use cases inside their core processes that drive productivity and help them accelerate everything they're doing. Software development, service and support, sales and marketing, content management and creation, and you also showed some great examples in advanced manufacturing. AI use cases are continuing to expand across all of large enterprises, and the urgency for generative AI continues to grow. And we're in this second year of the Gen AI phenomena, with enterprises demanding more AI acceleration options to meet their infrastructure needs.
So maybe talk a little bit about how Intel and Dell are working together to satisfy those needs.
Sure thing. So we're working hard to meet the demand and make AI adoption really easy for these enterprise customers with everything they need. A complete AI system architecture with the servers, the storage, the networking, specifically built for AI accelerated systems. And also, of course, the AI ready PCs and workstations. We also help them in the design and implementation with our AI solutions and professional services. And you know, last year we launched our PowerEdge XE9680, and it has really set the standard for purpose-built AI and generative AI compute with superior AI acceleration and diverse GPU options. And overall, the market is demanding more choice for AI compute. And we're working closely with your team at Intel to bring Gaudi 3 to market. Now, and we are super excited to be adding the Gaudi 3 AI accelerators to our PowerEdge XE9680 lineup this year. Pat, your team has done a great job here. It's a game changer. Gaudi 3 strengthens our partnership by addressing customer infrastructure needs, reducing TCO, and easing deployment. And it's all through an open ecosystem featuring AI frameworks optimized for Dell and Gaudi 3, along with scalable Ethernet-based AI fabrics. And prior to Gaudi 3's release, we're going to launch the PowerEdge XE9680 with Intel's AI accelerators in the Intel Developer Cloud, which is going to allow select customers to test the Intel AI solutions on Dell hardware before implementation in their data centers.
Well, sounds like incredibly good work that we're doing together, Michael. But you know, before I let you go, anything else we can be doing for you?
Well, we've always got a few requests, Pat. So
yeah, this is Michael.
It's been a lot of fun. it's been a lot of fun, you know, working super closely together, and. Something here just showed up. Working closely with your team to accelerate. And look, what we need is more Gaudi 3 in volume. That would be great.
Well, Michael, I think the next shipment has arrived.
Oh, wow. Awesome. Cool. I'm gonna go fire this up in our lab. Good to see you, Pat.
Well, I guess that call is over. And, you know, it's only fair to show what Michael has been excited about. You know, today, and maybe as we come to this point in the keynote, I'm excited to introduce the Intel Gaudi 3 AI Accelerator for the first time. So you ready? Intel Gaudi 3. You know, huge advancements in generative AI, building on the proven performance of Gaudi 2, delivering 4x the AI compute with BF16, 2x with FP8, 2x the networking bandwidth, 1.5x the memory bandwidth for massive scale-out, significant leap in performance for AI training, you know, popular LLMs, multi-model support, and Intel Gaudi 3 is architected from the ground up for efficient large-scale AI computing, supporting both scale-up and scale-out configurations. Gaudi 3 is great on benchmarks versus the H100 on top Open Llama models, 50% faster on time to train, 50% better on inferencing, 40% better on inference power efficiency. A scalable solution with Gaudi 3 using industry standard Ethernet, like we talked about before, scaling performance from one socket to a 8 accelerator UBB, a single node, up to thousands of nodes and racks. One of the key questions that our AI customers are asking us is, okay, how do I deploy? And nearly all of the Gen AI developments today are moving to higher level environments, PyTorch frameworks, and other community models from Hugging Face. Industry is quickly moving away from proprietary CUDA models. Literally, a few lines of code, and you're able to be up and running with industry standard frameworks on power performant, efficient Gaudi infrastructure. Now, let's talk a little bit more about availability and a bit nerdier, you know, together. Intel Gaudi 3 is available to OEMs starting this quarter of this year. 3 different industry standard form factors. The accelerator card that I was just showing off here to you. We're also adding to the Gaudi family a PCIe card. And finally, our universal baseboard. Man, look at this big boy. Yeah, I always bring Big Brother along with me. And, you know, with it, you know, that range of solutions, and here, you know, up to 14.6 FP8 petaflops, you know, greater than a terabyte of HBM3E, 192 native 200 gigabit Ethernet connections in this big boy. And with our first Gaudi PCIe card, extraordinary compute density, the same capabilities as the mezzanine card, giving our customers great flexibility, 1.8 petaflops of FP8 capabilities, 128 gigabytes of memory in 600 watt TDP, making them an easy adjunct to a Xeon deployment, you know, being able to deliver industry standard infrastructure into your data center. And Gaudi 3 eliminates vendor lock-in with standard networking solutions in your data centers, in your cloud, and with open software environments. Best of all, you ready? Huge TCO advantages for your deployment. You know, this is a winning solution. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Gaudi 3 generation. And as you saw today, the momentum is building, the roadmap is strong, we're seeing this acceleration of high performance computing, of AI workloads, of Intel Xeon, and our next generation Gaudi 3 solutions. And if you look at the Gaudi 3 customers today, you know, we see this growing momentum in the industry of our partners, our solutions, and customers who are now saying, man, this thing is great. So let's put it all together for our discussion today. And let's bring Brian on stage, and we're going to show just an enterprise application or two here to finish up, you know, our time together this morning. So, you know, Brian, you got anything good to show us?
I got a couple things, Pat.
Okay.
So first, you a little while ago, you were telling our audience here all about LLMs, chatbots, RAGs, and all that. So let me bring this all together and show you a cool enterprise edge AI use case here that every single one of you here in the audience are going to relate to. Email.
Okay.
You get hundreds of emails, especially to put on a show like Vision. It's ridiculous. So how can I use artificial intelligence to get me through these things quicker?
Yeah. So inbox zero, the holy grail.
The holy grail. Yeah. I can never get to that. All right, so here we have Outlook, a very familiar email interface, and our friends at Iterate AI have developed this Gen Pilot service. And as soon as I click on it, I get a summary of what my customer wants, and not just that, a suggested response that's going to give me all the information specific to the product that the customer is asking about. I didn't have to go through spec sheets, databases, or any of that. All I need to do is hit compose right here, and I have a template ready to go. I can adjust maybe the pricing or whatever, you know, but everything is right here ready to go in an email that everybody can relate
to. In just seconds. That's pretty impressive. Yeah? So, what else? That's going to help with my inbox, but we got a lot of other tasks.
Yes, yes, yeah. We do. And, you know, yesterday we actually recorded a podcast over here, so we could have used Audacity, not just to suppress the noise using AI, but also track separation, keep everything in their own track, you know? We could have used that.
I've started to play with Audacity on my PC.
Well, how's it going?
Yeah, well, you know, I have a face for radio and a voice for silent movies, so we're working on it.
We're working on it. Well, soon AI will fix those things too. For those of you with film editing, right, we have AI effects with Filmora. And then we also have a few photographers here. I saw a couple cameras earlier. Lightroom will help you with AI that can help you organize your photos, maybe do some quick edits, and all of that.
Well, that's pretty good. So what else do you got?
Okay, one more that I thought that was going to be kind of compelling for you and the audience here
okay.
is using AI locally on your system in real time. So maybe this looks a little familiar, the drawing on the left.
Yeah, that's the Ohio facility.
That's right, the Ohio facility. But yeah. I don't know why. If we are here in sunny Phoenix, why do we have it in a rainy scenario? Let's change this to sunny, and let's cue the prompt. And you'll see, Pat, in just seconds, this is going to come to life in a sunny environment with really very little to no effort on my part. And let's click it here. Here we go.
Okay.
And
like all live demos, let's see here.
Like all live demos.
Okay. Well, now we have
to. There we go.
Oh, there we go.
There we go. Well, so again. You know, okay. it's
Now, that didn't take me billions of dollars and years to build that fab. That was pretty good.
That was really good. Yeah. And again, you know, it's not just about how cool this is. It's about the experience I'm going to give to my customer. With just 10 extra seconds of effort, AI helped me come up with a photorealistic render of the Ohio fab that's still under construction.
Yeah. Oh, this is great, Brian. You have me sold.
All right. Well, you know, I know that we had some fun with this, you know, but again, the whole thing is about productivity. And I'm here to show the case for the demo guy. So
okay.
Yesterday I was looking for you, Pat, for the rehearsal, and they said that he was at a sporting event. So, you know, the whole thing was, okay, what if Pat was here? Well, no, what if I was with Pat? And then I came up with this. You know, I ran an LLM on my system. That's what it came up with. So what
okay,
do you say, Pat?
I think we're done.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think we are done.
Can we get some AI PCs for the demo?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Right. Okay, thank you, Brian. Yeah, I would have loved to be helping the Boilermakers last night, but my jump shot, you know, okay. You know, everything I've talked about today, it's not going to happen overnight, but it's also not going to take long. You know, we see this enterprise AI transformation, you know, happening right around us today, but we see it unfolding in three different stages. First, the age of the AI copilot. And you saw that today. I got this like really smart thing helping me do my job better, you know, helping me automate, streamline, optimize my tasks. And we expect productivity improvements of maybe 25%, you know, from those kind of capabilities. But the second age is nigh upon us, the age of agents, where the AI automates entire workflows. And you know, think about this like an autonomous car. I let go of the wheel, and it's doing it for me. The age of AI agents is nigh upon us. And we expect that enterprises will develop domain-specific models, and agents will program to act autonomously, you know, through their periods, and checkout agents and compliance and customer service automatically partnering with us 7x24. And with this, you know, just being able to unlock next phases of productivity. But the third age, the age of functions, where agents start to interact with other agents and literally entire departments become AI automated solutions. And maybe we'll have the age of the first one-person billion-dollar company as we look to it, securely unlocking the world's data that's still held inside of these databases on-prem that's not being leveraged today. And how do we, you know, bring this to every portion of our business operations? As you saw, I need to transform my manufacturing in our fabs. We need to be 10x better because the people I'm competing with, they have lower cost of labor. We have to out-innovate them using AI to drive our fabs and manufacturing. And each one of you need to do the same for your businesses as well. Where the technology is gaining cognitive capabilities as strong as humans in different domains. And we expect that we need not a little bit more computing power, but 10,000 times more computing power for this generation and achieving full AGI capabilities literally this decade. And as stewards of Moore's Law, we're going to relentlessly pursue more power-efficient computing. Because all of this that we've talked about today, everything we've talked about, is made possible by the power of silicon. As I said at the start, every company is going to become an AI company. Together, we'll unleash the power of your data. We're going to accelerate your productivity. We're going to enable your workforce. We're going to vastly improve the ROI of your technology investments, all while making it more sustainable and secure. Intel, we were made for moments like this. Together with all of you, we're going to change the world again. Thank you.
That you've seen what the future might hold with AI-enabled enterprise gold, automotive, financial, shipping, and more. With the right Woohoo chips, every business can soar. Success will be boundless, the future so bright, you'll have to wear shades well into the night. Intel's Enterprise Solutions, bringing AI everywhere.